Raven record label. So ladies and gentlemen, Thomas Borah.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, we're good. It's an honor for me to be here with you to share part of your afternoon. Thanks for coming. I'm a proud parent, along with my wife, of an 8-year-old boy and a 10-year-old girl. And one of our favorite things in life is the next Disney film, because movie night goes much better with Disney. Just a show of hands, how many of you have seen Encanto? Encanto? If you haven't seen it, I strongly recommend it. It's the latest one. I'm going to have to do a little backstory in order to have this lead into what I wanted to lead into. But the music has gotten super popular. So if you follow pop charts, we don't talk about Bruno as the number one. It's even more popular than Let It Go was from Frozen. Really great song. And I think the composer of the music, Lin-Manuel Miranda, how many of you have heard of him? He's a genius. And I read that he composed the song, We Don't Talk About Bruno, over a Zoom call with the creative team. That could be apocryphal, but I'll go with it. And what's cool about this song, We Don't Talk About Bruno, is it's based on a repeating chord progression. And it's really cool in the movie because it brings out different characters. So each character gets their turn to introduce themselves and further along the story on top of this bass line. And then it crescendos into the last kind of finale of this piece, and they're all singing their lines at the same time because it works over the same bass line into this crescendo. And the reason I bring that up is because another genius, who I think is a genius, is Bach. He wrote this Passacaglia and fugue in C minor using some of the same kind of ideas. He starts with a bass line that repeats throughout the piece, which you can hear. And the nice thing about it coming to a different organ and presenting it is it allows me to show the different characters of the organ, much like the movie shows different characters in the movie. And this particular piece also builds into a great crescendo. So the last variation is this great fugue. So I hope that you enjoy that part of it. It's a little bit of for those of you who do know What About Bruno, don't expect a Latin like show number. It's not that kind of a thing. The Passacaglia is, I think, one of the great masterworks of Western culture. So for you to just sit, let the piece wash over you, and let it transform you as only Bach can, I think is a great thing about this piece. I paired it with another piece that also is built on a repeating chord progression, but it's a much different piece. It's a nice contrast. So first the Passacaglia in fugue, and then the aria Anna Chacon. Thank you. The next piece is by John Knowles Payne, who was the very first music professor in America. His courses that he taught at Harvard, music theory and music appreciation, became the core of their curriculum. And as you might imagine, early pioneers in American music had to get their education from Europe, where the tradition was much more established. So he studied in Europe, and which takes me to the transition of the Austrian hymn. The Austrian hymn is a tune written by Franz Joseph Haydn. It was written by him in 1797. I grew up knowing it as Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken in the hymnal. That's kind of what comes to mind when I sing it and hear the tune. I understand from Pastor Keith here that you do God Who Made the Whirling Planets, which also goes with that tune. The tune has a storied history, a very tragic time in the beginning of the 20th century. But it's still surviving, and it's still the national anthem of Germany. They sing the third stanza when they do it. And in the new version of the Presbyterian hymnal, they acknowledge that history as part of it. It's important for me to play it. First of all, I started learning it when I was a kid and kind of naive to a lot of the things, bigger issues in life. But I think it's a really neat thing because as you listen to this piece, first of all, just let me backtrack. Haydn himself wrote a string quartet, and this tune provides the basis of a theme and variations in the second movement of that quartet. It's sometimes, I think it's Opus 76, it's the Emperor Quartet. And to play this piece, the John Knowles Payne, which I'm gonna play, as you start, in my imagination, it could very well be an extension of that Haydn piece that I know. The first two variations sound very much like Haydn. But then as he kind of goes on, he starts to establish his own voice, something maybe a little less refined, a little more boisterous, American, if you will. And this becomes an archetype for many pieces that were written in New England and beyond, including the pageant, which I'll play later, a set of concert variations. So this is the Austrian hymn, Concert Variations by John Knowles Payne.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all so much for being here today. We're going to take just a brief pause for a few announcements and to allow Tom a drink of water after that fancy pedal work. My name is Colin Knapp. I am the director of the Ypsilanti Pipe Organ Festival and the former director of music and organist here at First Presbyterian Church. Welcome. I am sad that the current director of music and organist, Mary Jim Thaney, can't be with us today, but she does send her best wishes to all of you. I'm so happy that you're able to be here to hear my former teacher, Thomas Barra. I studied with Tom at Interlochen in the summer of 2008, and I graduated high school there in 2010. There's another former Interlochen alumni in the audience today, and both of us can attest it is an absolutely magical place. If you know of a young musician who is talented and driven, please tell them about Interlochen. If they are meant to be at Interlochen, Interlochen will find a way to make sure that they are able to attend. It changed my life. And you know, in Tom's bio, it talks about him being a master teacher, and he truly is. So please keep that in mind if you know of any young musicians. At this time, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. As Ken noted, this series is funded completely by your generous donations. Our number one priority is to make sure that our artists are paid well and that these concerts remain open and free for our public. So whatever you're able to give, whether it be a dollar or five or 20, we really appreciate your support. And while they are doing that, I will quickly pitch the final concert of this year's series is Dr. Pamela Reuter-Feenstra, an extremely talented performer of many instruments, composer, improviser, and activist. She has put together a really incredible program that you can read a little bit about in the program, Stories of Our Time. She is going to tell stories through music. And if you are someone who likes to be the first to hear something, there won't only be one world premiere, there's going to be a few at this concert. So if you want to be the first to hear some really incredible new music for organ, please join us on Sunday, May 1st at 4 p.m. A quick show of hands, how many of you receive emails from the Ypsilanti Pipe Organ Festival? If you do not, and you want to hear about our season next year, we are coming up with a couple of really exciting programs. Please make sure that you use the sign-up sheets that we ask you to sign up or sign in on. If your email address is on there, we'll make sure that you receive emails. I promise it's 1 to 2 per concert, no more than that. I'm very mindful of making sure that we're not spamming mailboxes. So please make sure we have your email address so we can make sure you stay up to date with what's happening here at the church. That's all I have. So let's keep the music going. Please welcome Thomas Barra.
I said we'd come back to the Sowerby. It's the next piece on the program, and it follows in a long line of American composers writing concert variations. And I've noticed today that it's actually a subconscious theme of my program. So I did the John Knowles Payne, which was a set of variations, and then, if you noticed, the middle part of the Mozart was a set of variations, and now this. What I'd like you to listen for, you'll notice a lot of pedal. There's a lot of fanfare at the beginning, but then you'll hear the theme really clearly and some really pretty sounds, and it continues through there. He wrote this for an Italian organist, Fernando Germani, who, upon receiving the score, said, "Why don't you write me something really difficult?" And there was another connection, maybe a subconscious connection. The opening composer was an Italian who wrote a piece with lots of pedals, and then this is a piece for an Italian who played lots of pedals. And the funny thing is, during a lot of Italian organ history, they didn't have pedals. So maybe there's something, you know, making up for lost time or something like that. But this is the pageant. And then I'll talk a little bit about the next piece after this.
Thank you.
And now something for completely different by a Dutch composer, Ad Wamus, still living. And he is just newly into the organ scene. He kind of got a start as a keyboard player and composer and arranger. He's done a lot of music for films and TV shows, including Sesame Street. So it's kind of neat what someone from a different perspective can bring to the organ. It's called mirar, which means reflection. And I think what that has to do with is the right hand has an ostinato, but as things kind of phase around it, the piece kind of morphs in different directions, and it's pretty cool. So Ad Wamus, mirar.
Thank you.
The last piece doesn't really need an introduction, but my last chance on the microphone, I just want to thank you so much for coming out and sharing your afternoon with me. And I really want to thank my hosts, Ken and Jane, for just making me feel like a king here in Ypsilanti, and for Colin, who is just such a great energy and life force that kind of helped make this turn into something really special. And Pastor Keith and everyone who was part of making this great organ, congratulations, and thanks for having me. This is the Carillon to Westminster.